And therefore he tells them that though he was to go away, yet he would send another comforter, the Holy Ghost. And then they were overcome by an opinion that it would go worse with them when Christ was gone. Therefore Christ telleth them that it should be better for them. And indeed, it was better. Christ did not take away his blessed presence for their disadvantage, but for their good. God never takes anything from his children, but he maketh it up in a better kind.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome back to the Hondo Channel. There's this verse in John where Jesus is talking to his disciples, and this is right before he's going to die, right before he's going to be crucified, right before he's going to leave them. And so it's a very frightening time for the disciples. And one thing he says has always puzzled me, where he says, it's to your advantage that I go away, because then the Holy Spirit will be with you. And if I'm here, then the Holy Spirit won't be here. Which I always thought was very odd, that Christ would say that it's to your advantage, and to connect those two things together. I always thought was strange. The Holy Spirit and his absence. But I think it relates to the nature of faith and how we relate to the Holy Spirit and how we experience his guidance and his direction and his work in our lives. And I always talk about this faith and sight thing, and how the apologists and the Arminians and the free will and the open theists, they all rely on what they see and what they understand. And they're very limited, because when you do that, you can't know God. You can't know who God is. You can't understand who he is. You can't worship him in spirit and truth like Jesus says in John 3. But the whole nature of faith is that we trust when we don't see. We trust when we don't understand. We trust because we don't see and we don't understand. And in the last video, I talked about God removing things that we trust in. And God does this to believers too. And every time we suffer through something, we're learning not to trust in ourselves, but in God. And Elizabeth Elliot talks about this a lot. She says basically every trial that we go through, even the little things on a daily basis, they lead us to Christ, and they point us to Christ, because they first of all reveal that we're sinners and selfish and proud and impatient. And these little trials that we face every day do that. But the bigger trials, they remove things from us, remove our dependence on ourselves, remove the things that we see, that we trust in, that we understand, so that we can put our faith only in Jesus. And this thing with the Holy Spirit and Christ telling them that it's to your advantage that I go away, it is all of this. It is that the disciples had Jesus physically, bodily, they could see him. And so every time they struggle with something, they looked at him right there, physically, with their eyes. What do we do? Tell us what to do. But when Christ was gone, they didn't have that. And so they had to trust, they had to have faith, they had to know and believe that the Holy Spirit was within them and guiding them and teaching them. And if Christ was there bodily, they would not do that. But they would use their eyes and look to him. But he said, it was to your advantage that I go away, so that you will know and understand and believe in the Holy Spirit and believe in his work and relate to God directly, not through me and my body as I stand here, but have a direct relationship with God. And anyway, that's that. The nature of faith is like that. We don't trust in what we see, but in what the Word of God says. That God is within us, that he is in our hearts, that he keeps us forever. And no matter what makes sense to our eyes and to our minds. The Word of God is the only thing that is true. Everything else, God can take away at any time.
You know, all truth is God's truth.
And the guy in that last video I made said that psychology is God's truth. There's nothing that is stupider than that. There's nothing. I can't imagine anything as stupid as saying that. Psychology was created by godless pagans. I think that they can understand the soul apart from God. And for a Christian theologian to say something like that, it's just absurd. It is absurd, and it is a wicked thing. Any truth, anything that we call truth that is not from God directly, that is his attested to scripture, his word that he gave and he testified to it himself, everything else is the work of men. And while some may be more reliable than others, none of it is as true as the word of God. Not even close.
Faith means trusting in what you have good evidence to believe.
And Frank Turek and Geisler and all of his types. Geisler was the worst. He didn't believe in the Word of God unless he could prove the Word of God is true with science and with reason. And so essentially he did not believe in God, but in science and reason. And Turek is the same way. He says the same thing. Faith is believing in what you have good evidence to believe in, or faith is trusting in what you have good evidence to believe in. So the foundation of faith is our own sense and our own reason. But the problem with that is that we trust in ourselves. We trust in what we see and what we can figure out on our own. And essentially, it is pride. And faith, when it is blind, well, it is blind. Because faith is blind, it humbles us. And it causes us to not trust in ourselves, but only the Word of God. And this is what Thomas Watson says. Thomas Watson was a 17th century Puritan minister. Faith is believing the truths revealed in the Word because of divine authority. Only because God says so, not because we can figure it out, not because we can see the scientific evidence. That is not faith. And ultimately, faith humbles us because we're not trusting in ourselves, but in only the Word of God. Repentance and faith are both humbling graces. By repentance, a man abhors himself. By faith, he goes out of himself. The soul casts itself upon Jesus Christ. Faith rests on Christ's person, not on evidence and not on science, not on reason. Faith believes the promise, but that which faith rests upon in the promise is the person of Christ. Wherein lies the preciousness of faith? In its being the chief gospel grace, the head of the graces. As gold among the metals, so is faith among the graces. Paul said, "We live by faith." Meaning our lives in Christ begin and end by faith, in faith, through faith. And none of that is with any kind of evidence. There's a verse in Isaiah where God says, "Heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Where then is a house you could build for me? And where is a place that I may rest? For my hand made all these things. But to this one I will look, to him who is humble and contrite of spirit and who trembles at my word." We do not tremble at God's word when we seek to prove that it is true, when we trust in evidence and reason to try and establish for ourselves and for our own satisfaction, so that we can see it with our eyes and understand with our minds that God is true. That is the opposite of faith. That is the opposite of fearing God. It is to fear ourselves, and it is to respect ourselves before we respect God. It is to put our trust in ourselves. And all of Isaiah is just God absolutely humbling men, judging men, telling them that they are nothing without him, that they are grass, that they are insects, that they are dust, that he is in control, that he declares everything, that he guides everything to his own, by his own will, to his own purposes. And everything that is opposed to God's sovereignty, they call it God's decree, opposes God himself, opposes his word, opposes his greatness and his power and his wisdom and his authority and everything that makes him who he is. This is why I call these men atheists. They begin with atheism and they try to reach God with their atheism. It is absurd. It is absolutely absurd. Hondo! Hondo!